Greetings, dear aspirants, wishing you all a very happy and a prosperous new year ahead, and welcome to today's current affairs session of Civilspedia. Today we'll be discussing about Mahila Police Volunteer Scheme and about Sri Sadhguru Ram Singh Ji and about Ajivika Gramin Express Yojana under our prelims topic and about bioplastics and shipping industry under our mains topic. So let's move on to our first topic of the day, Mahila Police Volunteer Scheme. So Mahila is women and police volunteers. So, something about this topic that you need to know is about this particular scheme and which ministry is implementing the scheme, and something about the Nirbhaya Fund. Because the recent current affairs is some proposals of some of the states have been accepted by the central government under this Mahila Police Volunteer Scheme. So, this particular scheme aims to create a link between the police and the common citizens. Common citizens and police. So, a woman activist from a particular Gram Panchayat will be appointed as a police volunteer who will act as a liaison officer between the police and the citizens of that particular village. And one Mahila police volunteer per Gram Panchayat has been envisaged under this particular scheme. So, the Mahila police volunteers will be forming Mahila and Sishu Rakshak Dals. Mahila is women, Sishu is the children, and Rakshak is protection. So, women and child protection group will be formed by these Mahila police volunteers, and this is a honorarium post, and rupees 1000 per month will be paid from the Nirbhaya fund. So Nirbhaya fund was formed in the year 2013 post that Nirbhaya rape incident which happened in the state of New Delhi. So this particular fund was formed to work towards to distribute funds towards women protection and related rights to women. So this particular scheme is a joint initiative of the Ministry of Women and Child Development and the Ministry of Home Affairs. This you need to keep it in mind for prelims point of view. So let's move on to our next topic of the day, Sri Sadhguru Ram Singh Ji. So the 200th birth anniversary of Sri Sadhguru Ram Singh Ji was commemorated by the Indian government, and an international seminar was held under this particular head. So some of the keywords that you need to know about this particular personality is, you need to know something about the personality. He was a social reformer and the sect that he formed. So he founded the Namdhari sect of Sikhism and the Kuka movement which he foreled, and about the Sri Bhaini Sahib which is the place of worship of this particular Namdhari sect of Sikhs. So, something about the personality, Sri Sadhguru Ram Singh Ji. So, he was the founder of Namdhari sect of Sikhism in the year 1857, and he organized the Kuka movement. So, Namdharis are also called as Kukas. So, Sikhs recite the holy Guru Granth Sahib, and when some people sing it in a very high note in the classical music. So, that particular high note in Punjabi is called as Kuk. And hence the Namdharis derived the name Kukas, and they are very famous for their Kuk form of music, which is nothing but the classical music. So this particular Kuka movement aimed at overthrowing the British rule, because post the second Anglo-Sikh war, British took over the Punjab state, but Namdharis were against this, and many people from the regular Sikhs also joined the Namdhari movement. So Sri Sadhguru Ram Singh Ji, who founded the Kuka movement, was a social reformer. So he was against girl infanticide and against the satyati practice that was very much common in those days, and he advocated widow remarriage, especially under his particular sect. So this particular Namdhari sect, as I already mentioned, they are also called as Kukas. So they are very much known for their white dress ensembles. So they wear white kurtas, white churidar, pyjama, and round white turban on their head. And their place of worship is called as Sri Bhaini Sahib, which is located in the city of Ludhiana in the state of Punjab. And there, this particular sect is known for mass marriage system. So the marriage system is very simple, and they conduct their marriages during common religious gatherings. And it is very simple. There is no dowry. Dowry is completely banned under this particular sect. So this is all you need to know about the Namdhari sect and about Sri Sadhguru Ram Singh Ji. So let's move on to our next topic, Ajivika Gramin Express Yojana. So you need to know about this particular Yojana, what are the objectives of this particular mission, and which ministry is implementing this particular mission. So this mission was in recent news because there was some confusion amongst the parliamentarians, because there was some other Yojana in the name Gram Parivahan Yojana, but that is not true. There is no scheme by the government called Gram Parivahan Yojana. The government implements only the Ajivika Gramin Express Yojana, which is a subset of the National Rural Livelihood Mission. So something about the mission. So this mission aims to provide connectivity from the rural areas to the nearby urban areas. And this connectivity will be ensured by the members of those self-help groups or the family members of those self-help groups, that they will get a vehicle under this particular mission and they will transit the people from the villages to the nearby urban areas. So the funding is within this particular National Rural Urban Livelihood Mission, the NRLM fund. So there are three types of funds. One is the Vulnerability Reduction Fund. Vulnerability Reduction Fund. And second is the Revolving Fund. And third is the Community Investment Fund. So the funds for this particular subset of this NRLM mission will be given from the Community Investment Fund, which means basically interest-free loans given to those members of self-help groups or the family members of those members of the self-help groups. So they'll purchase a vehicle and they'll work it as a business model. And as of now, this particular mission has been implemented in 18 states. And the Ministry of Rural Development is coordinating this particular mission, the Ajivika Gramin Express Yojana. So Ajivika in Hindi is livelihood. And Gramin is villages. So whenever you are trying to read about Yojana, try to know that meaning of that particular Yojana. So you will get an idea, a very rough idea about that particular mission, and you might be able to know the particular ministry which is implementing the particular scheme as well. So there are two objectives under this particular Yojana, as I told. The first objective is to provide a safe, affordable and community monitored rural transport services. So this will give a alternative source of livelihood to the members of the self-help groups with the by providing the rural transport to the rural population. So these are the two objectives under this particular Yojana. Just read about the objectives, don't by heart them. So in question you will get this objective statements directly. So just have an view of these objectives. So let's move on to our main topic of the day, bioplastics. In this particular mains topic, I intend to explain what are bioplastics and what are the different raw materials used to prepare bioplastics, and what are the final products of the bioplastics, and what are the challenges to the bioplastic industry in India, some solutions that we can give. So what are bioplastics? Bioplastics are biodegradable plastics, which means they can be degraded upon waste once it has been become waste. And these are alternative to the conventional plastics. So the plastics can be derived from biomass sources, which is nothing but the natural plant sources. It can either be food based or non-food based. As of now, a large number of bioplastics are produced from food based biomass sources, and from non-food biomass sources. Now the technology is coming up, and let us see the different types of technology that are currently available. So these particular biodegradable plastics are compostable materials by an industrial process which can be composted within a period of 6 months with the help of microbes. So this is all about the bioplastics that you need to know. And you can also have this data which you can use it to give your introduction or some statistics for the mains answers. So the 2% of global plastic production is bio-based, which means only the 2% of the entire plastic industry in the world is bioplastic industry. And around 4.2 million tons of bioplastics is being produced annually. So this too will be useful for you. If you see, as a part of the Sustainable Development Goal 14, the World Ocean Conference was held. And the member nations were committed towards reducing the plastic pollution in the oceans. And they came up with their own ocean actions, country-wise ocean actions. So India also came up with its own ocean action. So one thing was the reduction of plastic pollution. So as a part of this, Indian government came up with the Clean India Mission, nothing but the Swachh Bharat Mission, to clean all those plastic waste that is spread in the natural areas and also on the coastal lines, especially under this particular SDG goal of 14. And if you see, the government of India has also banned the single-use plastics, plastics that are less than 50 microns. But bioplastics that are weighing less than 50 microns are allowed by the Indian government. Since they are biodegradable, they are used. They have been allowed by the Indian government. So this is one key point that you need to know under this particular intro. So there are two types of sources which I told. One is the food-based sources, and second thing is the non-food-based sources. And even in the food-based sources, you can classify into three. So basically, food is made up of carbohydrates, proteins, and fats, as you all know, fats or oils. So this carbohydrates yield starch. So this starch is used as a raw material for this particular bioplastics. So the starch can be from different food sources, maybe corn starch, tapioca starch, or cassava starches, etc. And for proteins, you can the sources can be soy, beans, and the protein-rich foods, etc. And for fats and oils, your normal vegetable fats or animal fats and oils. And recently, the technology is coming up by producing bioplastics from food waste, but it is at a very nascent stage. And we also have some non-food based bioplastic manufacturing. So they can be derived from your woody trees, shrubs, and grasses, tall grasses, and also from algae. If you see, this is the first generation feedstock. So the raw materials are called as feedstocks as per the bioplastics industry terms. So these are all the first generation feedstock. And food waste, woody grass, and woody trees are the second generation feedstock. And algae would be the third generation feedstock. And you need to know two bioplastic compounds, major bioplastic compounds. First thing is the polylactic acid. So it is a starch extracted from food crops like the corn and cassava. Nothing but the tapioca, the root of cassava. And second component is the polyhydroxyalkanoates. So it is synthesized by having bacterial feed on the fats, vegetable oils, and also the sugar, basically derived from the food crops. So food-based resources and the bioplastic compounds, the polylactic acid and polyhydroxyalkanoates. So these both are majorly being produced or manufactured in the Western nations and are being imported at large by the Indian industry. And the end product of these particular bioplastics is these bioplastic compounds, along with the conventional plastic compounds and along with some other chemical compounds, can be used to form or produce the carry bags, cutleries, films, food containers, bin liners, etc. So these are some of the end products. So you can expect a question in prelims that what are the possible end products that can be formed with the help of bioplastics. So you can just have a look at this. And what are the bioplastic compounds, polylactic acid and polyhydroxyalkanoates? So just have this in mind. So you need to know about the challenges of the bioplastics industry, because bioplastic industry is at a very nascent stage in India and also at the world level. So there is clearly a particular policy has not been framed by any of the governments, including the Indian government. So you can split your challenges into SLEP mode. Go for social, legal, economic, political, technological. Split it. So let's focus on the technological challenges that the India faces with respect to bioplastics industry. First thing is the higher imports and the higher duty that is being given to these raw materials, especially the polylactic acid and the hydroxyalkanoates that I told. So as of now, the duty is about 18% GST plus 10% customs duty for this particular raw material. So the tax structure is very much high for the raw material. So your end product is also more likely to be high, because the consumption rate is very low. So the product cost is also likely to increase, because as of now, you can get single-use plastics and other plastic materials which are very much cheaper compared to bioplastics. So the normal public and even the normal industry, small-scale industries, would prefer the conventional plastics towards the bioplastics. So, and second point is, a majority of the bioplastic plastics are derived from the food-based sources. Already, we have some issue in the world, the malnutrition problem. So we need enough food to supply for the entire world. But if you are using that particular food to form bioplastics, the general population will be deprived of the normal food that they get. So it is more likely to lead to a food crisis situation. And as I told, the manufacturing cost for these bioplastics are also very much high because the technology is at a very nascent stage. If you see, around 2 euros per kg is the manufacturing cost in the year 2016 in Europe continent. Whereas a conventional plastic, formed with the help of the polyesters, so it was roughly about 1.2 to 1.4 euros in the year 2016. So it is almost double the production cost of these conventional plastics. So these are some of the technological challenges that the bioplastic industry faces. And also the cost, final cost is thrice as much as the conventional plastic. So nobody is going to orient towards the bioplastic. And the lack of innovation and technology in India, this is a very common point. So we can give some political suggestions. So let us give a suggestions on the later slide. And also economically, if you see, this is the product cost. So it is not quite economical. So this is one economical challenge. And the legal arena, if you see, lack of bioplastics labeling and certification in India. If you see, Karnataka government in the month of June 2018 has also banned the single-use bioplastics because they are being the normal conventional plastics are being forged as bioplastics and are being sold in the market. And when the Karnataka government took some samples and checked, these particular forged materials were not degrading. Hence, the Karnataka government completely banned the bioplastics because of the lack of proper labeling and certification environment in India, it is more likely prone to happen. If you also see, Maharashtra government banned the single-use plastics usage in the later half of 2018. But there were not any other alternative measures in place before the ban was to take place. So the entire state suffered, especially the Mumbai, the financial capital of India, suffered a lot. So you should have a proper backup plan before implementing the single-use plastics ban. And if you see at panchayat level, composting infrastructure is not there. So the governments will come up with a ban and they'll very strictly or stringently impose bans. But later they'll pull away all those bans because they do not have a proper infrastructure in place to go for the alternative measures. One such alternative measure is the composting infrastructure. For all those bioplastics industry, you need to have a proper composting infrastructure because an industrial composting method is required so that these particular bioplastics can be degraded within a period of 6 months with the help of microbes. And if you see, at social level, lack of awareness of the common public about the waste segregation. One thing you should remember is bioplastics, if you just leave as such in the environment, it is not going to degrade very immediately. Of course, it's going to degrade, but it will take a comparably huger amount of time, but lesser than that of the conventional plastics. So it needs an industrial composting environment to properly degrade. So the social awareness among the people regarding the segregation of waste is highly crucial because we can even now see the general public throwing plastics in the open areas and even during transport. Such things should be curbed and there should be a proper social awareness amongst the general public in order to curb the plastics issue, pollution issue. So these are some of the challenges. And as I told, there are three generation of feedstocks. So it has been explained here. As of now, the cost is very much high for the first generation feedstock. But with the development of second generation feedstock from the woody trees and grass and third generation feedstock from algae, the cost is more likely to get cheaper because the dependency on the food-based sources is going to lessen. And you can give some way forward based on this SLEPT mode only. So as I told, for a social mode, more public awareness has to be increased. And for legal, you can give a suggestion that the country has to come up with a proper bioplastic labeling and certification environment in the country. And for economical, you can give that the GST for this particular product has to be brought down. So this is some of the policy interventions that the government has to do. And also the government has to reduce the import duty. So this can be an e-mode. And politically, the government has also should also come up with imposing a buyback policy for bioplastics and also should impose an extended producer responsibility among those companies which produce the bioplastics. In such way, the government has to intervene into the bioplastics industry. And technologically, the government has also should boost up the innovation mood of the academic institutions in the country. So these are some of the way forwards that you can give under the bioplastics topic. So this is all about bioplastics topic that you need to know. So let's move on to our next main topic, the shipping industry. So I intend to give some of the policy interventions and the government initiatives of the shipping industries and some of the statistics of this particular year 2018 of the shipping industry. So some of the policy interventions made towards our shipping industry is the amendment of the model concession agreement. So with that, by amending this particular model concession amendment, PPP has been enabled in the shipping industry. So this has given a boost to the investors. And second thing is the revision of tariff guidelines in this particular shipping industry so that more shipping is being enabled. And facilitating the ease of doing business by giving immediate approvals to those companies who wanted to start shipping business in India. And also enhancing the infrastructure. So this is also a part of Sagarmala program. So speedy implementation of the Sagarmala program. So it is the program is about boosting the shipping industry with minimum infrastructure investment. So India has a huge coastline and also a huge amount of inland waterways which are easily navigable. So the government intends to make use of this particular inland waterways and the coastal area with minimum investment and enhancing the post capacity, which is also minimum investment, infrastructure investment by the country. And if you see some of the government initiatives taken, first thing is the Sagarmala program, and some initiatives have been taken towards the inland waterway transport sector. So the first thing is the construction of the multimodal terminal at Varanasi in the state of Uttar Pradesh, and cargo transport has been started from Kolkata to Varanasi, and there was also recent news that PepsiCo transferred its cargo from Kolkata to Patna. And integrated cargo movement has been initiated from Kahalgaon in the Bihar district to Pandun, Assam state, which crosses over three waterways, through Ganga, through Brahmaputra, and also to the Bangladesh waterway. So these are some of the government initiatives and some of the statistics of the shipping industry for the year 2018. First thing is the cargo handling capacity has increased to 1,451 million tons per annum. So this was roughly around 744 in the year 2014 MTPA. So it has almost doubled. And also the traffic capacity of the ports has also increased. The 12 major ports has also increased to 403 million tons up to the month of October 2018. And capacity expansion has also been mooted by the government. Some six new ports have been identified, two in Tamil Nadu, one in Karnataka, Andhra, West Bengal and Maharashtra. And the number of ships under the Indian flag has also increased to 1,399, which can handle 2.79 million tons. But it is very much less compared to the world arena, but significantly higher if you see in terms of improvement in India. And the number of seafarers has also increased to 1.8 lakhs. And in terms of cruise tourism, government has given approval for operating the Mumbai to Goa cruise service and inauguration of the international cruise terminal at Chennai in Tamil Nadu state. So these are some of the initiatives taken by the shipping industry in this particular year 2018. So this is all about the topic and the discussion. So please do like, comment and share the video, and please subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Wishing you all again a very happy and a prosperous and a very successful new year ahead. Thank you.